On August 3, 2022, the latest eruption of the Krýsuvík volcanic system within Iceland began. Since this eruption has just entered its 11th day, we have been able to note a number of notable changes. The most obvious of which is an eruptive rate which appears to still be declining, although it may have stabilized. Whereas the lava effusion on August 6th, when I first visited the volcano in person, looked like this, on the 10th, it looked like this. Despite the reduced rate at which fresh lava is erupting, the volcano is now generating even taller lava fountains than beforehand. Using a methodology based on the amount of time it takes for a fragment to fall, I was able to estimate a maximum lava fountain height of around 100 meters or 328 feet. This could be occurring for a number of reasons, but one possibility is that the magma conduit has constricted slightly, causing approximately the same pressure to be released in a smaller area. All of this latest activity has allowed the existing spatter cone to grow by about 50 to 70% over the last 4 days to a height of around 27 meters or 89 feet. Despite the decreased lava flow effusion, the eruption is showing no obvious signs that it will end anytime soon. One methodology used to describe if an eruption has ended or is about to end is by measuring the rate of harmonic tremor. At volcanoes, harmonic tremor only occurs due to the movement of magma or volcanic gases. Since the eruption began, the rate of harmonic tremor has actually increased, albeit slightly. Associated ground deformation is also continuing, but at a lessened rate than witnessed in the days leading up to the eruption. While viewing the eruption in person or through a series of live streams, you might note areas where lava is spattering upwards far away from where the current 360-meter-long eruptive fissure is. Despite looking like small spatter cones, these features are not examples of such, and in fact are not directly associated with a separate magma conduit. Rather, these lava blobs are forming in a manner similar to how a blowhole can form on a seaside cave. While still warm, lava erupted in prior days has a far higher viscosity compared to newly erupted lava. As a result, when fresh lava interacts with the harder lava flow, gravity and natural turbulence of the flow causes the material to expand outwards due to the injection of fresh molten rock. Lava is subsequently forced upwards at a series of vents and cracks near the edge of where the older lava is located, which results in it being ejected vertically. These features are more common while lava effusion rates are higher and less common when lava effusion rates are lower. The aforementioned interaction of older and new lava flows from the same eruption has formed a step-like ridge which rises perhaps 5 to 8 meters above the lower lava flow. Occasionally, a small section of the side of these ridges will collapse, resulting in lava breaking out as an ah-ah flow to form a fan of material, thus expanding the size of the ridge. While close to the erupting lava on August 6th, I measured air temperatures of over 150 degrees Fahrenheit or 66 degrees Celsius. Several of my viewers were wondering why this didn't burn my skin, as the same temperature of water would cause a near instantaneous severe burn. The reason is that air has a much lower thermal conductivity than water. In other words, water is much more efficient at transferring heat than air is, so a short-term exposure of superheated air on my skin did not result in a burn. Thanks for watching. If you would like to request a specific topic, please leave a comment below. Additionally, I would like to thank my new patron, Parker O'Halloran, for supporting this channel.